is. A sluice is a mining term. When you are panning or mining for gold, you will put what you have dug into a stream of water that is channeled by a wooden sluice, and it will bring everything down in that water, and as it comes down, there is a netting or a fencing that will catch the particles, the larger particles, and let the fluids go on by. It's a form of panning for gold. You know, panning is you put stuff in your pan and get water in it and you slosh it around and then pour the water out gently, and the heavier stuff ends up on the bottom, and a lot of times that's gold nuggets. I'm saying all that to say this. Deep calleth unto deep at the sound of the sluice, thy sluice, which means that the golden nuggets of truth have to be picked out, found, discovered as you process through things. You find the nuggets. But deep is looking for deep. If you're mining for gold, what are you looking for?
Gold.
If you are have a depth, then you're looking for something deep. So deep calleth to deep at the sluice, where the nuggets are caught, and you save that which is precious and let that which is not go on by. Keep that in mind today as we process through truth. We have Diane puts little magazine racks at home, and I noticed in one of those magazine racks this week, my eyes fell on a periodical that we get from a ministry that we are affiliated with on a monthly basis. And I noticed that the sticker on it said, Richard and Diane Davis. That was who it was mailed to. Richard and Diane. No, I'm sorry. It didn't say Richard and Diane. It said Richard and Wendy Davis. Richard and Wendy Davis. And my mind was quickened. That's one of those nuggets. My mind was quickened by the Spirit. And the word that came to me right away was covenant. The reason we are called by the same name, Davis, is because we entered into a covenant together, a marriage covenant. And they twain, according to the Bible, shall become one. Two become one. That is a unity, a joining, a covenanting that is important in the kingdom of God. Not just for marriage, but anything that God joins. As a matter of fact, in Mark 10 and 9 it says, what God hath joined together, let not man put asunder. What God hath joined together. In our dining room, there is a painting. And from our bedroom, we can see into the dining room when the door is open. And the painting in our dining room is of fruit. It's of a table, and it's got some flowers and fruits and stuff. And as paintings are, it's not like a photograph. It's a It's a painting that looks a little bit like that church back there. It's a little fuzzy, but you see everything. And a few weeks ago, I wake up every morning. When I wake up every morning, the first thing I see is that painting hanging on that wall in there. Diane can't see it from her side of the bed as easily as I can. But I noticed as the sun shined on that painting, there were two little white lines that have really no business being on that painting. It's like two small, just minute, about the size of a toothpick, shafts of white light that are coming out of a sort of a golden glow that is over that table in that painting. Two shafts, and they are like falling out of that golden glow, and it's just perfectly straight and together. It could be like a railroad track. It's that synchronized. And I saw it a few weeks ago for the first time. I've observed that painting for years, but that's the first time I ever saw those two little minute white lines. And immediately my mind says, me and Diane, we just run on the same track, same level. Except when she's wrong, then I don't go wrong. Anyway. It was like two shafts of light together, covenant, agreement. And in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 7, there's a word that you don't hear preached about very often, but it's talking about husband and wife, and said if you are in disagreement, now I'm paraphrasing, says if you're in disagreement about something, settle it, get it settled, that your prayers be not hindered. In other words, disagreement hinders your prayers. And not just in marriage, but in anything that God has joined you to. If you are in disagreement, then it will hinder your focus in prayer. Now, I'm saying all this for a reason. This is all preliminary, and I'm headed towards something. But I want you to see with me that the harmony of the Spirit is a force, a spiritual force that brings in things into agreement and alignment and unity. God created the world of the Spirit, and He created the world of the natural. And the Spirit controls the natural. The natural does not control the spiritual. But when you understand it, you understand that the laws of the Spirit are where the kingdom of God functions and operates. And that has precedent over the laws of earth. As a matter of fact, that's the reason Jesus said, pray, thy kingdom come. In other words, your will be done here instead of our will, instead of earth's way, your will be done here. That requires us coming into agreement with heaven. And heaven then is able to move in our behalf because we have come into alignment and into agreement so that God does not violate Himself to bless us or to help us. Amen. Now, having said all of that, I want to take you to a scripture that is found in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 10. But before I get there, I want to pass out this paper to you, if I may. Thank you. These are the words to a country song. And I just want to play this, and I want you to hear it because the message in it is what I'm talking about. You don't need the words. You're not singing it. I'm going to go ahead and start playing it, but I'd like you to have access to these words.
It was 700 fence posts from door place to house. Neither one of us was old enough to drive a car. Sometimes it was raining, sometimes it would shine. We wore out that gravel road between your house and mine. I'd start walking your way, you'd start walking mine. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, or chapter 1, verse 10, here's what it says. Now I beseech you, or I beg of you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. What did I just tell you
that I saw on that little magazine, I saw Richard and Diane Davis. That's who it was sent to. That's how it got to us. And we were both called by the same name. I beseech you by the name. We are in his name. We have the power of attorney and authority of his name. And so Paul said, I'm beseeching you that you are one with him. Recognize, remember that. Then he goes on to say that you all speak the same thing and that there be no divisions among you and that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. Now the word name there is talking about the name of Jesus. We gather in his name. He said, where two or three are gathered together, what? In my name. It is his name that makes us related because we are his family. Then the second thing says, speak the same thing. That means speak with unity, not division, not I think this. It's we agree on the authority of God's word. He has spoken. And we come into alignment with it. That makes us one because we are on the same truth. You see that? Then the next thing he said, that there be no divisions. The devil always tries to drive wedges between God's people. He always does. He'll look for something to offend you with. He'll look for somebody to say something or not say something or do something or not do something. Or in somehow or another, it'll strike you wrong, it'll rub you wrong, and before you know it, you're in disagreement. What's that going to do to your prayers?
Hinder.
He said, come together in the name, speak the same thing. Then he says, be perfectly, don't have any division, don't let any wedges come between you. Recognize what the devil's trying to do. And then he says, be perfectly joined together. The only way to be perfectly joined together is not by your decision, but by the power of the Holy Spirit. And you coming into alignment and agreement with that. Amen?
Amen.
The power of the Spirit is the only thing that can put us in perfect joining together. And finally, he says that your prayers, no, finally he says you are to have one mind, that means think alike, and then to have agreement. Symphonio, harmony. That's the reason I've titled this, The Harmony of the Spirit. God can symphonize his church. God can symphonize his people. The devil has worked hard and long to keep us divided. We are in, for the most part, denominations. That's two words, nations and denama. Denama means to divide the nation. Divide the nation. And that's exactly, and I'm talking about the nation of God, not any earthly nation. Satan wants to denom us, to divide us. That is what he seeks to do. But if we can come together, which is God's goal for us, to grow together, then look out, kingdom of darkness. Look out, planet Earth, because the heirs are going to rise up.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. With one mind and one accord. Mm-hmm. Now, in John chapter 17, Jesus is getting ready to go to the cross, be crucified, suffer, die, and go to hell for us. But before he does that, he gathers his disciples together and gives them last words. Last words are important words, y'all. I want you to notice, and I'm going to read this paraphrased version out of the 17th chapter of the book of John. I'm going to read verse 15, 16, 20, and 21 because I don't have time to deal with the rest of it. Jesus said, he's praying. He's praying to the Father. And he says, I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world. That right there is an important philosophy because most of the church world right now is so weary and tired that they just want to escape out of here and go to heaven. But if God wanted you there, you'd be there. But you're here. So what does that say? We're supposed to still be here. The ones that are there, praise God. Hallelujah. We're going there. But don't go till you get done. Now, I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world, but that thou shouldest keep them from the evil that is in the world. They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Set them apart through thy truth, thy word. Neither pray I for these alone, but for all of them also which shall believe on me through their word, that they all may be one, that the world may believe. It's the oneness, the unity, the love of God's people coming together as one that will convince the world. Right now, we are not a witness. Well, we are a witness, we're just not a good one. We're not the witness that we're supposed to be. The Spirit of God was given to us for specific reasons. And one of the first ones is to unify us. To unify us. Now, Satan's first action was to divide angels in heaven. When he sinned and was ordered out, he divided angels from angels. He's a wedge driver. He's a divider, and he separated angels from angels and brought some with him. The next thing he did when he got to planet Earth and God made man here was he started driving wedges between Adam and Eve. He came to her and talked to her. And then the next thing you know, Adam's blaming Eve, Eve blaming God. Everybody's at odds. Why? Because Satan was driving division wedges between people. That's what he does. He is expert at it. Look around you. Look around you in this world. Division is the devil's playground. Division comes from two words. Divided vision. Divided vision. Division. If Satan can drive a wedge, he divides our vision. If our vision is divided, we are not unified. If we are not unified, then our prayers have lost at least 50% of their effectiveness. That's very eye-opening. The devil comes from the Greek word diabolos, and it means to divide. That's what the word devil means, the divider. It means to separate, to set at odds against each other. That's what he does. And it's never been more evident than it is today. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8. Satan, as a roaring lion, seeks whom he may devour. Now my question to you is, what does a charging lion do? A charging lion, what does he do?
Roars.
He roars.
Intimidates.
If he's trying to sneak up on you, he's not going to roar. He's not lying in wait. He's not an ambush in this occasion. He is charging. He is walking about, seeking whom he may devour, and he is roaring. What does that do to the herd?
Scares them, shakes them up, divides them.
Puts them in a panic. It's either going to do one or two things. It's going to either put them in confusion or put them in unity. Mm-hmm. Hello, y'all. I'm talking to you now. A charging lion is going to do one or two things to the herd. He's either going to set them in panic and they'll start hurting each other, and all he's got to do is take the wounded, or they will herd together, get closely packed together, and face him in unity, knowing he cannot eat them all. So it's going to do one or two things. The roaring lion will either scatter the herd or unify the herd. Look at your world today. Look at the world today. Luke 11:17. Every kingdom divided, Jesus said, against itself is brought to desolation, and a house divided shall fall. Jesus said it, and it was absolute truth. Look how Satan worked in the early church. Paul was a powerhouse for God. He teamed up with Barnabas. Man, they were the dynamic. But all of a sudden, they came into disagreement over John Mark. Barnabas wanted to take John Mark with him, and Paul said, no, he's already failed us once, and I'm not having him. So guess what happened? Paul and Barnabas separated. That's what the devil wanted. Look down the line now. Paul is the apostle to the Gentiles. Peter's the apostle to the Jews. And they come into disagreement over circumcision. And Peter doesn't treat the Gentiles like he treats the Jews. And Paul gets offended. So now you got Peter. Paul said, I withstood him to the face, for he was to be blamed. That's not agreement. That's disagreement. That's division. Now they worked it out. Thank God they worked it out. But the devil was having a lot of fun, charging them and dividing them like any lion can do. Paul later on is teamed up with a fellow named Demas. He writes a letter after a little while and says, Demas hath forsaken me, having loved this present world. Paul and Demas came into odds. You might say, well, Paul was just he was the problem. That's not necessarily true. Paul was a powerhouse, and Satan put a target on him. That's exactly what happened. So Satan is the author of division. He will put you against people you love and that love you. He's a master at doing that. He will make you resent somebody. He will make you disdain somebody. You won't do anything to hurt them. You just don't want to be around them. I understand that. Yeah. Hey, look, I've been pastoring for over 50 years. I understand that. What we have to do is recognize the devil at his own game. And the more he tries to divide us, the more together we ought to be.
Amen.
It's time to come together, y'all. It's time. United we
stand.
Divided we
fall.
Say it again. United
we stand.
Divided
we fall.
That's true of any house. That's true of any relationship. That's true of any organization. That's true of any government or nation. That's true of any bank or any corporation. It's true of anything. Divided you fall. United you stand. The devil knows this very well. At a time when the world is more connected than it has ever been before in history, we are instead more divided than ever. Everybody's connected. Everybody's got the internet. Everybody's got radio, television, mass media. Everybody's got the technology. We're connected. We're more connected than we've ever been. But we're more divided than we have ever been. Why is that? Because Satan is using something that can bring us together to pull us apart. Because that's how he rolls. That's who he is. Most people would hesitate to speak a divisive word against you face to face. But they will quickly and sharply speak from behind the veil of technology against you without even blinking an eye. Why? Anonymous. I can say what I think because nobody's going to know who said it. Hey, y'all, if it's in your heart, it's in your heart. Whether anybody knows it or not. Come on now, I'm shucking it to the cop today.
Yep.
We are in a crossfire of division on an unprecedented level in this generation. Yes. Never before has it been that way. You can have family members at the dinner table, each one on their little device, totally and completely in a different world, together yet separate. Oh, but it serves such a purpose. I need to know. It's a divisive spirit. This is a spiritual matter. It's not a technological matter. It's a spiritual matter. Technology is just a tool. Satan has all kinds of tools. There is on this generation released a spirit of division. I don't care if you don't know that, it's still true. A spirit of division is released on this generation. We have free access to millions of people who are connecting to keyboards. And those keyboards are connecting them to everything and anything that Satan has composed for them. You know it's true. You know it's true. Social media is anything but social. Mm-hmm. It's divisive media.
Yeah.
It has its benefits, but it also has unleashed a new and powerful method of division. Never before seen on planet Earth. No other generation has had to fight this battle. We engage in anonymous destruction. Say that. Anonymous destruction. We can tear it down and burn it with technology. What are we going to do about all this? What's the solution? What's the answer? The Spirit. Every human being has a spirit. If he didn't, he wouldn't be alive. It's the Spirit that gives life. It's the Spirit who holds the key to unity. We're all of the same planet. We're all of the same earth. Every nation, every kindred, every tongue, every people, that's how it's described in the book of Revelation, is going to stand before God. Every nation, every kindred, every tribe, every language, every people, every color, all of us are going to be. We are one blood. He hath made us all of one blood. And yet we are so divided. The Jews against the Arabs. The Chinese against the Americans. The Russians against the Ukrainians. Oh, the Italians against the Swedes. Hey, everybody has their own axe to grind. But what spirit are you of? Jesus turned to James and John when they wanted to call fire down on somebody, and they probably deserved a little fire. But Jesus turned to them, he said, you don't know what spirit you are of. You don't know what spirit you're of. You don't know what's driving you to feel that way. I found myself this week just wanting to punch somebody out. Because they were just stupid evil. Stupid evil. And I told Diane, I said, I wish that I could find a big old dead fish and take that thing by the tail and smack them right in the face. I said that. Well, I bet you're the preacher. Yeah. I'm also human.
That's right. Very good.
There is such a thing as righteous indignation.
Yep.
Jesus had it. He flipped their tables over,
yep,
y'all.
He sure
and
is.
Weaved a whip. I mean, he knew what he was doing. He took time meticulously weaving a whip.
Yeah.
Yep, go ahead. Takes that whip and starts pop, 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 pop. Get out of here. Get out of here. This is my Father's house. It's a house of prayer. You've made it a den of thieves. Get out. Was that nice?
No.
Oh, and I bet you if he'd have had a dead fish, he'd have hit him.
Yep.
There's time for righteous indignation. There's times for discipline. There's times to face the music, so to speak. But not for God's people when they are together.
Jesus.
It's not us against us. It's the devil against us. He is the enemy, Your Honor. We've got to learn how to come into the harmony of the Spirit. That's the only solution to technological complexity. James chapter 3, verse 6, and this is paraphrased. The lawless tongue is a destructive fire that engenders the evils of hell. And it works real well on social media. The lawless tongue. The poison keyboard. Amen. Listen, if the lawless tongue is a destructive fire, like James said, then we're committing spiritual arson with our technology every day. Come on, y'all, this is the truth. Mm-hmm. Spiritual arson. Romans chapter 16, verse 17. Mark them which cause divisions among you. Well, I'm going to mark them today. Media causing divisions. They're causing divisions, and a nation divided cannot
stand.
What's driving it? Money. Money. The media is the Delilah of this generation. They're lulling Samson to sleep in her lap in order to drain all the strength. That's the media. That's what they're doing. They're sapping the strength of the church, because the church is to hold the moral standard, the torch of morality in this world. It's not the government's job. It's the church's job.
That's right.
Media is Delilah. Put your head in my lap, Samson. Tell me what's in your heart. Yeah. He ends up shaven and blind. You know what they're selling? They're selling trans. T-R-A-N-S, trans. Mm-hmm. They're selling transgender. Mm-hmm. Transhuman. That's what AI is. It's transhuman. Mm-hmm. Artificial intelligence. That's transhuman. They're selling trans. They're selling transvaluation. They're telling you this is worth something. This is not worth anything. That's transvaluation. That's what they're selling. They're changing the value systems. They're selling transmutation. They are mutating things into other things that ought not to be, but they're selling it.
Yep.
Because, oh, it's the popular opinion. They're selling transsexual. Mm-hmm. They're selling transnational. Flood the border. Flood it. Like we care about those people. Where's my fish? We don't care about those people. Transmorgification. What is that, Pastor? That's perversion. Morgification is perverting. selling their trans. They're selling their transvestite, where masculine dresses like feminine, and feminine dresses like masculine. They're selling their trans. You know what they're selling? Transgression!
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'm going to pass all y'all out.
I know, I'm telling you. Come on.
1 Peter chapter 4, verse 17. Numbers are important. 4, door. 17, spiritual perfection. The time has come that judgment must begin at the house of God. Now see, we've preached that. I've heard it preached for years. And the take that the pulpit has had on it is, God's going to get you if you sin, and he's going to make an example of you. And boy, God's going, he going to straighten your string. He going to clean your plow. He going to mess you up. Oh, he going to put you under judgment. It's not what it means. You go back to the original text. The word judgment there does not mean punishment. It means discernment and decision. What it's saying is, for the time has come that discernment and decision must begin at the house of God. It's going to have to happen here before it'll ever happen there. We are stewards of the grace of God, the manifold grace of God. We have been very good students, or stewards. Students either